what time it is? It's time to worship God. So welcome to Happy Hour at the world-famous Salvation Saloon's Water and Old Church. Get ready to be blessed. So sit back, hang on, and enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
All right, yes. Welcome, everybody, to the famous Salvation Saloon. And I'll tell you what, we're going to have a lot of fun worshiping God today. So I hope you're ready for that. Amen. Huh?
Sing with us.
The Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting
I hope that's a theme song for everybody. Well, we're stepping back into the past again. Back to Buzzy Days. Back to Buzzy Days again. This song has been with this church for a very long time. Okay. And it doesn't show any sense of not being here. Let's call it that way, all right? In days of old, when men were bold, there lived a man named John. He was real rough and he was real tough. He was on a mission for God. Promised land. Some fun.
Amen, amen.
Oh, well, now we got something really special.
Yes. Uh-huh. Well, the next song is a very sweet song and speak to our hearts because, everybody has a problem. Everybody has something to deal with. And sometimes God let us go through that valley just to develop character. And this song reminds me actually a verse from the Bible that we all, the Saloonic chick, and I hope that I'm saying it right, we have this verse every month. We have a biblical verse every month, and this one is from Psalm 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. And that's the promise that we're gonna conquer.
And you guys may remember this song from when you were growing up as little kids in church, but I guarantee you that this one is a little bit more powerful than that. As I listened to this song for many, many years, and none of them touch me like this version does.
Celebrate this glorious thought. He's taken all our sins and nailed them to the cross. Coming back for us to take us to the mansion that he's prepared.
And the Lord hastes the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back. Scroll.
Oh, man. Hey, good morning, everybody. And first of all, obviously, I just need to thank you all for all your prayers and concern. God is good, and from what I understand, I'm way ahead of where I should be, and I know that's because of your prayers, so thank you so much. I do appreciate and love you guys, and again, I'm glad I had you guys there with me. Lifting up my recovery in prayer, so, because prayer does work, amen? All right, well, first of all, like we do in every service, I want to make sure that I welcome everyone here. If you're here for the first time, we call this Happy Hour. This is our world-famous Salvation Saloon Happy Hour church service. And also for those of you who are here, we always like to start off by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. And we truly believe you're going to be blessed today. There's one thing that we would ask you to do, if you don't mind, and that is if you just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place. And if you would, just throw your name in that, tell us where you're from, that'd be cool. But then, if you'd hold on to this card till the end of the service and right down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. You can then take this card, and on your way out, there'll be a bucket by the door, and you can throw that card in that bucket. But again, God bless you for being here this morning, and you are our guest, so sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. Everyone else knows that we do have a couple of the other purposes for these cards, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, well, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer, is for prayer. So if you have a need in your life, just please put it down here and give God an opportunity to show himself strong. Because again, we know that prayer does work, right? Amen? All right, Bible tells us this about prayer. It tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but it also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. All right. Well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family, and like every family, well, we always try to make sure that we recognize each other, and by gory, I believe we got us an anniversary, don't we, Rob?
Oh, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary. Pour a cheerful toast and fill it, happy anniversary, but be careful you don't spill it, happy anniversary. Oh, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary.
All right. Congratulations, Spunky. And, hey, we also got a birthday. Here it is. All right. Happy birthday, Eric, and we're glad you're here this morning. And there is a game we play each and every week, and that game is called Name That Saloonatic. If you are here for the first time, just so you know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics, and every week we try to come up with an old picture and throw it up, and we try to guess who it is. And let's see what you guys can do with this. See if you can tell me who this Saloonatic is. Jester, Mike Baker? Mike Baker? All right. Most of you said Mike Baker. Did anyone say any other guesses? Pretty convinced. Pastor Paul? Well, let's find out. Well, the real Saloonatic, please stand up. Oh, man. I thought we were going to get him on that one. Apparently, we didn't. That is Mike Baker. All right. Well, what else do we got going on here? Just to give you an update on the Biggest Loser contest. First of all, you guys are almost there. We're almost at the finish line. Just two more weeks, two more weigh-ins? Next week. So you guys got a week, finish strong. There is a lot of money that's on the line. I do understand that there's actually a husband and wife battling for first place, maybe, from what I hear. So that's kind of cool. So we'll all see how it plays out next week. So, again, keep on keeping on. Finish strong, guys. And I have one more thing just to kind of pass on. Kind of a sad note because, man, we love our church family here. And we're going to be losing another Saloonatic member, although it's not going to be one of those final goodbyes that we've had plenty of as of the past few years. But I do want to pass this on if you haven't already heard. But Ron Heck, Condor, is moving to Indiana. He's moving to Indiana because his son is there. And, man, he knows he needs to be there too. And I think that is a good godly decision, and but he is and has been one of my very best friends here for quite a few years. He's one of the founding members of the Posse Motorcycle Ministry, and he is truly going to be an impossible guy to replace because he's that go-to guy. If we ever need anything, you give him a call and he's there. And again, he's going to be hard to replace. And he's going to be greatly missed. But obviously, we don't want him to forget us. And so I'm going to have Danny come up. And actually, if I can have all the posse members also come up, too. All right. Anyways, from the posse and from all your church family, Grizzly has this plaque. All right. And Ron, I know you get a discount on air flight.
What's that?
I know you get a discount on your air flights. Yeah. So you need to come down and visit. And when you do, come down and ride with us. Always bring your vest with you because you're always a member of this fellowship here and of that ministry. And I got two bikes, so you're covered there. All right? All right.
Oh, maybe we should.
what she's done. Okay.
Hello. Hi, I managed to get up here without any bad music, which I, sorry, just thought I'd notice that I made it all by myself with no music.
We can fix that.
No, you can't fix that. We're glad, I'm afraid you can fix it. Glad you're all here today, and we're all here today. Ron, we're going to miss you, but we know how happy your son must be that you're going. I think you're a great dad, so that's a wonderful thing to do. It's going to be cold up there, and your riding season is a little shorter. I'm from Maine, so riding is a little shorter season in Indiana. Just keep that in mind. In addition to us all being here because we love one another and are a family, I wanted to share that today is National Gold Star Mother's Day, and I don't know how many of you are familiar. Gold Star mothers, back during World War II, there was a soldier that was lost, and his remains not identified for a long time. And so his mother, to kind of be good, be kind to her own heart, went about working with other veterans. She worked in hospitals. She worked wherever she could with veterans that didn't have family around or did, and that was her kind of way. And then eventually the son's body was identified, and this group of 25 women got together and created a group called the Gold Star Mothers, and it became a national group. They're all over the country, and in a few years back, it was changed to Gold Star Mothers and Family. And there was a little flag that they would hang in the window, and you'd particularly see it around congregated areas of military, maybe a base or housing close to it. There's a little flag with a blue star. It means that you have someone overseas. That changes to a gold star when you've lost someone. So today is National Gold Star Mother and Family Day, and we pray for all those who have lost someone and honor their service. So I just wanted to let everybody know that. And today we're going to take our tithe and offering, and I will pray us into that. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so blessed to be here as a family, so blessed to love one another. Ron will be gone for a while, but he'll come back, and he'll be in our hearts always. And Lord, be with him. And thank you, Lord, for Pastor Paul being back with us. And I think I was remiss last week in being prayerful and mindful that we're blessed to have Pastor Bill, who can step in so that we're not without a pastor when Paul has to be ill or out for some reason. We are twice blessed. And so, Lord, I pray that you'll be with each one of us and be with, open our hearts as we listen to Paul's message. And Lord, bless the gift and the giver of this offering. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
One of my favorite songs we do, always is. Shaking,
For there's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Chance when I stand in your love, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Well, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand.
All right. Great to be back, and kind of excited about this chapter. I've been waiting. We started 1 Corinthians. I was looking forward to coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and finally we're there. So we're here in chapter 13 today, which means we last left off in chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians. And it was in chapter 12 that that Paul spoke about spiritual gifts, right? The gifts of the Spirit. And, man, there were a whole lot of some really cool spiritual gifts there. And to just remind you guys, there was, like, the gift of prophecy. There was the gift of healing. And then there was even that gift of miraculous powers. And, wow, I'm thinking that one would certainly gain some notoriety for someone. But as we also learned, that's not the purpose behind these gifts, because they're not for our benefit. These gifts are not for our benefit, but these gifts are for the mutual benefit of the whole church and of the gospel. And so we need to be conscious of the fact that God is the source of all these gifts, and so they're for his glory and not for our glory. Amen? Also, we learned that it's not all those crazy supernatural gifts that are necessarily the best and most beneficial. And that's why Paul concluded the last chapter, chapter 12, by stating this, and that was he let us know that we need to eagerly desire and seek after the best gifts. He ended the chapter by saying we need to eagerly desire and seek after the best gifts. And so now, continuing with that thought, it's in verse 1 of chapter 13 that Paul makes this statement. And that is, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but I do not have love, then I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Or in other words, right, if love is not involved, then all we're doing is making a bunch of noise. All we're doing is making a bunch of noise. And then there's this in verse 2, and that is, if I have the gift of prophecy, and can fathom all mysteries and knowledge, or if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, Paul says, then I am nothing. I am nothing. Now, I don't know, maybe that does sound a little familiar to some of you, because the Posse Band used to do this song called the Love Medley, and the first verse was from a song that was called Righteous Rocker, which was a song from the early Christian rock pioneer Larry Norman, who used this verse to explain God's love. There he is right there. Who used this verse to explain God's love to the 60s generation Jesus movement hippies. And here's the lyrics, just to remind you guys. Song was Righteous Rocker, and the lyrics went like this. You can be a righteous rocker or a holy roller. You can be most anything. You can be a holy prophet and get a blessing off it. And you could fast for 50 days. But without love, you are nothing. Without love, you are nothing. So here's the key. The key is love. Amen? The key is love. And you know, that's what the whole hippie generation based all their hope in, right? It was, their motto was make love, not war, right? Because as generation prophets, the Beatles said, well, all you need is love. All you need is love. But here's where they missed it. They missed it because love actually comes in different forms. And I'm going to kind of review that as far as the Greek goes. So in the Greek, there is, I'm going to go over three types of love. And first one I'm going to take a look at is called phileo. Phileo. And phileo speaks of an emotional love, the kind of love that we would have like for our family and for friends. And it literally means brotherly love, brotherly love. So it's the Greek word phileo, well, that is the actual root word for Philadelphia, the city of Philadelphia, which is appropriately known as city of brotherly love. Then here's another word in the Greek that is used for love, and that is eros, which is where we get the word erotic, right? And that would speak of a physical and a sexual love, which back in high school, that's what we call making out, right? And that, eros, that was the love that the hippies back in the 60s that they had based their movement on. But what they found is that physical love, well, it ended up coming with some consequences, right? Such as all those sexually transmitted diseases that they were spreading all over the place, as well as all those unplanned and unwanted pregnancies. And so eventually, the love that they thought was the answer, well, it let them down. It let them down, and that is when the 70s rolled in, right? And suddenly, all those songs of love that were once the guiding light to a generation, well, all of a sudden, it went from songs of love to everybody is kung fu fighting. Yeah, remember that one? That is one of those famous one-hit wonders. I looked it up this week. That actually sold 11 million records. 11 million records. And so from there, before we all knew it, those hippies, they ended up trading in all their groovy clothes for suits and ties, and they became young urban professionals. Remember that? Yuppies? They became yuppies, and they now sought to fill their emptiness through materialism, but that didn't live up to its promise either. Anyways, when they had attached their generation to love, I mean, they were actually kind of on the right track. But again, love comes in different forms. And the love that Paul, though, is speaking of here, well, it is from the Greek word agape. Agape. So agape love, or God's love, right? And it's God's love because this love describes the divine nature of God. Because by way of definition, it was John who actually stated that God is love. God is love, right? And not only is God's love unconditional, but it is also a giving and an active love, okay? Which is certainly confirmed in John 3:16 by a God who so loved the world that he gave us his only son, Jesus. A God who so loved the world that he gave us his only son, Jesus, who in turn, he gave us his life. He gave us his life. And so even beyond a giving love, well, God's love, it is also sacrificial, right? Because it was given at a great cost, at the, pay the ultimate price, right? And that is a love. That is a love. This agape love, that's a love that proves itself, right? Because that's a love that just cannot be denied. Because it has no limits. It has no limits. And so, since the word Christian means Christ-like, Christian means Christ-like, then that's why it was Paul who stated this in Galatians chapter 5. He stated that it's through this love, this agape love, that we are to serve one another. It is through this love, this agape love, that we are to serve one another. And then we come to verse 3, which says this. It says, if I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, kind of like, you know, look how holy I am, right? But if glory was the motive and not love, then it's Paul who concludes again, I gain nothing. I gain nothing. So basically what Paul is saying here is he's saying that even if we had all these great gifts from God, and even if we did all these great works of kindness, but yet the motive behind them was not love, then it's all meaningless. Or at least it's meaningless to God, right? And we know that. Paul just spoke about this a few chapters back, but we know this. We know that it is not so much our works that God desires as it is the motive in our hearts that are behind those works. Amen? So, what does this agape love actually look like? Well, Paul is now going to break it down for us, and this is really, really pretty cool. He begins in verse 4 by saying this. Love is patient. Love is patient. Now, we know that being patient through trials and through difficult situations, we know that's a very important principle. But here, that's not what Paul's referring to. Here, he is specifically talking about relational love, right? So it's talking about being patient with people. And that is so important because we, right, as people, man, we are so quick to give up on each other. We're so quick to give up on each other. But God wants us, he's telling us here, that he wants us to have a patient love, right? A patient love that's able to endure all the sin and inconsistencies that make such a mess out of people's lives, right? And to those of you who may be here who just keep falling, right, over and over and over again, and you're just having a hard time trying to accept that God could still actually love you, well, you need to see this, right? Because again, this is describing God's love. This is describing God's love. And then, following patience, love is kind. Love is kind. So love is patient and it's compassionate, right? Compassionate like that of a mother, right, whose child continually messes up, right? But yet a mother's love, it just keeps pressing on. It just keeps pressing on. Now, the flip side of that patient love is when, you know, we come to this point in life and we just say, well, you know, enough is enough, right? Enough is enough. I'm gonna show them. And we've all been there, I think. But that's not a kind love. That's not a kind love. In fact, sounds a little like vengeance, doesn't it? Right? And vengeance, according to the Bible, that does not belong to us, right? Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. So despite a person's spiritual condition, we need to continue to love them and pray that God maintains his mercy and grace in their lives. Amen? And then, moving right along, Paul says this, and that is, he tells us that love does not envy. Love does not envy. Well, have you ever gotten jealous because someone got blessed and you didn't? I'm thinking we've probably all been there. Because, you know, a lot of times, it's like it doesn't even make sense, right? When God blesses someone that we're convinced are less deserving than we are. But if you think about that, well, that sure does sound a little prideful. That sounds a little prideful. Anyways, here's the thing. It is not for us to always understand why things happen the way they do, right? Because as the Bible says, the sun rises on the just and on the unjust. And so what we need to do is we just need to trust that God knows what he's doing, and we need to be there to praise him and praise him, whether it's us getting blessed or it's others getting blessed. And besides, when it comes to envy and or resentment or any of the other fleshly emotions, when it comes to all of that, here's the thing. Man, that's a heavy load to carry. That becomes a heavy load to carry. And the thing is, it gets heavier and heavier the longer we keep it around. And so we just can't allow those fleshly desires to take root in the first place. Because carrying that stuff around never ends well. It never ends well. Because sin will always take us to where we don't want to go. Sin always takes us where we don't want to go. And then Paul says this about love. He says, love does not boast and it is not proud. Well, boasting is the opposite of envy, right? It is actually the act of making others envious. And we certainly don't want to be putting that on anyone else. And so here's the thing. If we've been blessed in life, then we better recognize that God is the author of those blessings, right? Not us. And with that in mind, well, it's in Proverbs chapter 6. It's there that it actually lists the seven abominations of the Lord. You guys have probably heard of that. Seven abominations of the Lord. Seven things that God just detests and hates. And what is it, do you suppose, is at the very top of that list? It is pride. It is pride, right? And God hates pride because pride is self-righteousness. And self-righteousness says, I did it. And that's simply blasphemous. That is blasphemous, right? Because God's the author of all good things. Then we come to verse 5, where it says that love does not dishonor others. Love does not dishonor others. Love is respectful, right? Because who are we to ever dishonor or to be rude to anyone? Who are we to ever dishonor people or be rude to people? Have you ever come across someone in life that is just mean and miserable? I mean, they're just nasty and rude, and no matter how nice you are to them, I have, and I'm sure some of you have too. But what's worse is what I could even say that on a few of those occasions when I met people like that, I then found out along the way that those miserable people, they actually profess to be Christians. And again, that's blasphemous, right? That should not be. That should not be. So we should honor and respect others just as we would want others to honor and respect us. And what's that? That's a golden rule, right? Unto others as you would have them do unto you. And so love is not rude, and it is not self-seeking. It's not self-seeking or selfish. Love is not selfish. In fact, the Bible says we are to seek the good of others above ourselves. Right? Actually, it was Paul in 1 Corinthians that just stated that a few chapters back. We are to seek the good of others above ourselves. Which again, man, that is exactly the type of love that Jesus demonstrated. Amen? That's what Jesus demonstrated when he sacrificed his own life for the lives of others. All right, here's an actual tombstone in England, and this is what's inscribed on it. It says, here lies a miser who lived for himself. He cared for nothing but gathering wealth. Now where he is and how he fares, nobody knows and nobody cares. Be a pretty sad description, right, of to leave behind of ourselves. Certainly would. So then we continue. And Paul says this. He says, love is also, so it's not self-seeking, and it is not also not easily angered. not easily angered. Now, one of the fruits of the Spirit happens to be self-control, right? So if you're here and you have a problem controlling your anger, then what you need to do is you need to ask the Holy Spirit for some assistance, right? Because self-control is one of his fruits, right? And if you are really, truly sincere, and I guarantee you, he will bring about a change in your life. He will bring about a change in your life. And then we come to this one. Here's a really great attribute of love. Love keeps no record of wrongs. Love keeps no record of wrongs. So this agape love, it's also a forgiving love. It's a forgiving love. In fact, the Bible tells us this. The Bible tells us that God not only forgives our sin, but he forgets our sins. Compliments of the finished work of Christ. Amen? So, not only forgives our sin, but forgets our sin. That is how thoroughly and complete God's forgiveness is. And that is why we refer to his grace as being amazing. Amen? Amazing grace, how great the sound that saved a wretch like me. All right, speaking of forgiveness, I'm sure some of you probably remember this story, the story where Peter went up to Jesus. He asked Jesus how many times we should forgive. And thinking that he was going to actually impress Jesus, well, he said, well, how about 7 times, Lord? Right? And the reason that he thought that would be so impressive is because Jewish tradition said that you only had to forgive a person 3 times, right? Because I guess it was like in baseball, right? 3 strikes and you're out. But what did Jesus say about that? What did Jesus say about that? Well, Jesus said not just 7 times, but 70 times 7. 70 times 7. Or in other words, what Jesus was saying is we just got to keep on forgiving. We need to keep on forgiving because with love, forgiveness is not a matter of mathematics, right? And looking at myself and looking at all my failures, I am sure glad Jesus came up with that one. And so, just as the Bible says, the Bible tells us that love covers a multitude of sins. Love covers a multitude of sins. And then in verse 6, we find that love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. Now, that's saying that we need to believe the best in people, right? Which would mean let's not get sucked into a bunch of unsubstantiated gossip, okay? Which, by the way, right, along with creating division within a church, gossip is also one of those 7 abominations of God. It is also one of those 7 abominations of God. And so we need to give people the benefit of the doubt, right? Because love believes the best in people and not the worst. Which reminds me of a story. A story of these 3 preachers that got together to confess their struggles and to pray for each other. So they were getting together to be like accountability partners. And so they meet, and the first preacher, well, he embarrassingly confesses that he had a problem with the bottle. The second preacher admitted that he was a womanizer. And when it came to the third preacher, well, he just jumped up and he just was running for the door. And when the 2 preachers asked him where he was going, well, he yells back, well, I'm a gossiper and I just can't wait to get out of here. And so I guess having an accountability partner is probably a good thing, but you need to be careful when you decide who that person's going to be, I guess. I don't know. All right. Then we come to verse 7, and we see that love covers all these things. It says it always protects, it always trusts, and it always hopes, because we can count on love to always have our backs. We can count on love to always have our backs. And then we have this attribute, as it then says that love, it always perseveres, always perseveres, always endures, all right? It is that agape love, that divine love of God. Well, it is that love that will always endure, and it will endure through anything that could ever come between us and our God. It will endure through anything that could ever come between us and our God. And That's what we find confirmed in Romans chapter 8 when it says this there. Romans chapter 8 says, who or what shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, but in all these things, we are more than conquerors. More than conquerors through God who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers or anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So this agape love, this divine love of God, and this is a powerful thing. It is a powerful thing. And to seal the deal in verse 8, well, this love, it never fails. It never fails. Now, I don't know what you may be thinking about all this. But to me, and I think all of this, all this stuff we've just gone over, man, I think it's just beautiful. Right? And I think it is so beautiful that we should marinate ourselves in these verses, right? As often as we can. As often as we can, we should open the book and go to that and just soak in those words. Because to God, man, this love that he's talking about here in the love chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, man, that's where it's at. That's where it's at. And so because I believe that and believe that so strongly, it's the first time I've ever done this, but I'm going to give you guys a homework lesson. All right? Not a big deal to the women. But here's what I'd like us all to do. Sometime this week, let's go to this chapter, right? And what I want you to do is to read through those first seven verses. And when you do, I want us to provide a little self-examination as we're going through each one of those attributes of love, right? And a good way to do that is to actually put your name there in the place of the word love. So it'd be something like, you know, Anne is patient and Anne is kind. And I buy that, right? But if I was to set up here right now, let's say I went through everybody's name and did that, there would be probably a few names and a few attributes that just might cause us all to start to laugh because they just wouldn't go together. And, of course, that would send an embarrassing message as to what that person would need to work on. All right, we're not going to do that. We won't do that. But instead, again, I'm going to leave it up to you to just kind of do that on your own. And then in those areas where, you know that you fall short, well, that's where you're going to need to call on the Holy Spirit for some assistance. And, again, if we are truly sincere, if you are truly sincere, he will provide it. He will provide that assistance because our God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Amen? Our God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And then by being doers of God's word and not hearers only, well, that's when we're going to start to grow, and that's when we're going to start to mature in our faith, and that is when we are going to become more like the person and the servant that God wants us to be. Amen? And that's something that we should be striving for at all times. So there you go. I'm going to leave you with that to just go over those verses again this week. But let me just close with this. I'm going to leave you with this. And that is, if God is love, then the phrase, all you need is love, well, that would actually translate to this, and that is, all we need is God. Amen. All we really need is God. And here's Billy to close.
Everybody's watching Paul to make sure he gets there from here to there. Oh, he's doing great, but he's scaring the crap out of me. Especially up here at Dave's little obstacle course. All right. So there it is. God is love, right? We knew that. And that's really kind of, you know, it all blends together, everything we talk about all the time. Sermon a couple weeks ago was on that. Focus on whatever's kind, whatever's beautiful, whatever's lovely. Focus on love and not the division that we see all around us. You turn the news on and this group hates that group and this one hates them. And, you know, there is no middle ground anymore. And nobody wants to work together to try and get anything done. They just want to yell at each other. And, you know, where's Christ in that? So for us, you know, thank God we have a church family and we have a God that provides for us. And those crazy people can do what they do. And we'll just do what God says. And I bet you we win. You know, because at the end of the day, we've read the story and we've read the Bible and we know that love wins. Love wins. The devil has his moment and he can cause all kind of havoc in our lives now. But when it's all said and done, love wins. And we win because we belong to Jesus Christ. So take that, devil. Have a good day. So anyway, listen, we're so glad you guys are here, and we're so excited to continue with this series. So next week, we're going to move on to chapter 14. So hopefully you'll be here to join us, and those of you watching online, so excited to have you too. Drop us a note, say hi. We always love to hear from you. And before we go, we never want to close the service without giving you an opportunity to make sure that you know that you know that you know that you have that blessed assurance that if today was your last day, you know where you're going. Right, you know that you could stand before Jesus in the blink of an eye and be okay, right? Because you belong to him. Because a humble heart and a simple prayer changes literally your forever. So say this prayer with me. Say, dear God, I don't have all the answers, but I know you do. So from this point on, I want to rely on you by accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So please forgive me. Make all things new. And by the power of your grace, I will now seek to follow you and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Congratulations. Welcome to the family. For those of you that said that prayer for the first time or said it again and meant it different this time, because sometimes we got to start over and that's okay. Right? We have a loving God who perseveres. Love perseveres. Love wins, right? So we just dust ourselves off and we keep trying. So we've got some exciting stuff coming up. We're going to have a new Bible study series we're putting together. The holidays are right around the corner. They're already decorating. Christmas stuff is already out at Home Depot and Walmart. Moon Lake already has pumpkin spice crystal meth out. So the holidays are here. Right, so I'll be ready for that. So listen, we love you, and we just, so start thinking about who it is that you want to spend Christmas with. Who is it that you're going to invite this year to our Christmas spectacular, Christmas whatever, extravaganza, whatever you want to call it. Who is it that you want to bring that day? Start thinking about it. And be ready to invite them because we're going to have a really good time. Suzanne makes great hot chocolate. That's a little hint. So anyway, let me pray for us and we'll get out of here. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for that we could be in your house this morning, God. And we thank you, more importantly, for your presence here today. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Paul's recovery. We thank you that you're blessing that whole situation and that he's here with us today, God. We love him and we thank you for all you're doing. And Lord, we know that you're healing him because we've been praying for Suzanne, because Suzanne needs help to take care of him. Father, just bless them both, Lord, with healing and patience and let love win there all the time. Father, we just love you and we love everything that you've done for us. God, I ask that you bless all the families represented here. Father, I ask that you have your way with this hurricane, that if you could diminish it and send it somewhere else, that would be wonderful, but we don't want to sicken on anybody else. We just want it to calm down and not kill anyone. Lord, so have your way with that mess. As always, protect our troops and our first responders. And God, please help our elected leaders to do what's right and what's pleasing to you and good for the people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Love y'all. See you next week.